Galatians. We're going to look at chapter 3, the very end of chapter 3, and the beginning of chapter 4, Galatians chapter 3, verse 26. If you want to use the Pew Bible, it's on page 694 in that Bible. But Galatians chapter 3, we're going to look at verses 26 through 29, then 4, 1 through 7 this morning. And I'd like to ask you, if you're able to today, to stand for the reading of God's Word, Galatians chapter 3, starting with verse 26. And here the Bible says, "For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. And if ye be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed, and heirs according to the promise. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. But when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son, and if a son, then an heir of God through Christ." I'd like to preach just for a few minutes this morning on adopted with full inheritance. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your word today. God, may you bless it, Lord. Help me to be able to stand boldly and strong in your wisdom and power. God, give me the thoughts today, Lord, to help hearts. Lord, would you just convict them with your Holy Spirit today of the word? For it's these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Well, this passage of scripture written by the Apostle Paul there to the churches of Galatia, and he's instructing them on the lives of a Christian, as he often always had to do with new Christians in Christ. That was always Paul's theme, seemed like. If he wasn't trying to save his brother Hebrews there, he was trying to save the Gentiles or get them saved by letting them understand the importance of Jesus Christ and what all he means to them once they are saved. He spent a lot of time in doctrine, and I know we get afraid of that word doctrine today. You hear that word and all of a sudden you go like that. Well, don't do that this morning. This is different. This is something exciting out of God's Word. And as I read this and studied it, I couldn't help but just really get overjoyed and excited about what God's Word says about us, about things that He's gave us. He has gave us this, and I like I said, I titled this Adopted with Full Inheritance. I don't know if you really understand what all that entails, what all the Bible tells us that we are going to receive because of Christ. Now, I'm not one of those health, wealth, and prosperity pastors, and you know that for a fact, but I want you to know that Jesus does give us some promises in His Word that is going to come to His people, to His children, to His sons, to His heirs, and we're going to look at that this morning. You know, growing up, my parents raised foster children for about 5 years. We had 15 different kids. I believe it's 15. 15 different kids in and out of our house over a span of 5 years. We didn't know from day to day who was going to be sitting at the table. I mean, one day there might be 10 of us, one day five, but you never know. I mean, at one time we had bunk beds in one room. We had two sets of bunk beds in one room, and every kid in there wet the bed. But I tell you what, it was a trying time back in those days for a young man. I believe I was 12 or 13 when we first started getting foster children. But my parents kept these foster children, and I personally witnessed how they treated them. You know, you've heard of some awful times and awful cases about foster kids. And you see that movie, who is it, Annie, and how awful she was treated. But it was not like that in our home. The foster children that came in our home were not treated any differently than I was treated, than my two sisters were treated. We were the blood children there, me and Pam and Jennifer. But then these other children came, and they wasn't treated any different than we were. We all sat at the same table. We all partook of the same food. We all fought over the last piece of chicken. I mean, it was all these things. They had as much rights as we had sitting there in our house being foster children. If you didn't know better, you would think they belonged to my parents. I mean, there was no difference. In the midst of this fostering that my parents did, they adopted one. Now, you all know who he is. It's my brother, Josh. And notice I said my brother Josh. I didn't say my adopted brother Josh. I didn't say my foster brother. I didn't say my half-brother. I didn't say, you know, somebody else's brother from another mother. I said he's my brother. He is my brother. He was adopted, and he has all the same full rights as I have, as my sisters had in our family. We may not have the same blood running through our bodies, but we have the same parents now. He has the same rights. He's not restricted from privileges. He doesn't get anything less than I do. He's not in fear of being unadopted. He never had to fear that he was going to be thrown out. But he has the same full benefits, the same inheritance, the same everything that I have, because he's been adopted into my family and to my parents. Now he calls my dad his dad. And so we have the same father, and we have the same mother. So we belong to the same family. We're part of him. I like the way that God says he adopts us. Look again at verse 7 of chapter 4, or verse 4, chapter 4 of Galatians there, 4 and 7. He said, "Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ." Now if you back up there into verse 6, we'll look at that one. It says, "And because you're sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father." You know what that word Abba means? That's an Aramaic word. It's a term of endearment, and what it really means, the way we would say it, would be daddy. It means daddy. My dad, my precious father, the one that loves me, the one that is over me, the one that takes care of me. I love you. And the Bible says here, because we are saved, because we belong to him, we become a son. And not only we become a son, we become an heir, but we can call him Abba, Father, through the Spirit of Jesus. We call him daddy. Dad, my Father, Jesus. We have that same relationship with God as Jesus does, because we're the same once we come into Christ. Let me tell you a little something about sonship in the days of Paul, the apostle. Hebrews did it. The Romans did it. The Romans had a law, and it was called patria potestas. And what this law was, that the father had full rights over his children, over his sons. He owned everything of those sons. If they ever come into any kind of money, they had any kind of lands, anything like that, that belonged to the father. He had all rights over them. The Bible is said there about them in Galatians 4:1 that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant. In those days, the son, as he was under this age, a certain age, he had no more rights than a slave did, even though one day he was going to inherit everything, even though he would get it all. But at that time, as he was just a son there, and he was the same as a servant. And so he had no other rights other than that. His father owned him. His father had the authority over his life or death. If his father said, "I want to do away with the son," it was his right. He owned him. It was just like a slave. And he had no rights of his own. And so when Paul's writing this, these Hebrews, they fully understand what he's talking about when he says, "You've come out of that. You're no longer a servant, but you are a son. You have full inheritance. Everything that your father has is yours." And we remember that prodigal son. Remember when he came to him wanting to get his early inheritance, and he came to him, "Father, give me everything that's mine. I'm out of here." And he took it all and liquidated it into cash and went off to another land and spent everything he had. It's that type of thing. Once they come into their own and they get everything that the father has. May I say to you this morning, unless you've been adopted by God through Jesus Christ, you don't have any rights at all to any inheritance. You have no rights to inheritance of heaven. You have no rights to inheritance to the Father. You have no rights to anything unless you've become adopted by God through Jesus Christ. Those not adopted by God will perish in their sins. The Bible's very clear on that. You will perish in your sins. You will die, and you will go to a devil's hell, and you will burn forever. The Bible tells us that. That's why Jesus makes this statement here this morning. And John 14:6, he said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." So the only way to become adopted into God's family, the only way God is your true father, is if he adopts you through his son, Jesus Christ. You then become an heir of God. You become a real bona fide son of God. Now, people say, "We're all God's children." Well, in a sense, we are God's children, that he created everyone. But you do not belong to God if you've not been saved. You're not one of his sons. You're not one of his children. In fact, the Bible tells us that you are a son of the devil. Turn with me to the Gospel of John, chapter 8, verse 31. John, chapter 8, verse 31. Don't want anybody to be confused this morning and think that I'm teaching some kind of heresy that we don't belong to God if we're not saved. Let's look at it. John, chapter 8, verse 31. Now, Jesus, he's there. He's dealing with those guys again, those Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes. I mean, all these religious guys. In verse 31 of John chapter 8, the Bible says, "Then Jesus, to those Jews which believed in on him, said, If you continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and truth shall make you free. They answered him, We be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free?" Now these guys believed because they were heirs of Abraham or had the blood of Abraham somewhere down in their lineage down years and years ago that they were not slaves, they were free. And what do you mean calling us slaves? We've never been in bondage. They was in bondage the whole time. They was in bondage in Egypt and was led out. They was in bondage everywhere they went. But here they say, well, what do you mean you make us free? Verse 34, Jesus answered them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the Son abideth ever. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. I know that you are Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me, because my word has no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my Father, and you do that which you have seen with your father. There's two distinctions there. He said, I'm doing the will of my Father, and you're doing the will of your Father. Now, there's a separation there. And he says, verse 39, they answered and said to him, Abraham is our father. Jesus said to them, If you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. But now you seek to kill me, a man that has told you the truth, which I have heard of God. This did not Abraham. Ye do the deeds of your father. Then said they unto him, We be not born of fornication. We have one father, even God. Jesus said to them, If God were your father, you would love me. For I proceeded forth and came from God, neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do you not understand my speech? Even because you cannot hear my word. Verse 44, Ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. Jesus told those guys straight in their face, he said, You don't belong to God the Father, you belong to your father, the devil. It's pretty plain, if you don't belong to God, you belong to the devil. It's one or the other. You can't belong to both at the same time. So we must be born unto Jesus Christ, into the Father's family through Jesus Christ. It's the only way through. It said there, we become an heir of God, an heir of God. When we're adopted in his family, we're only adopted in his family through placing our faith in his son, Jesus Christ. And then we are led to faith in Jesus by the Spirit of God. Look in Romans 8 and 14. Romans 8 and 14, if you're ever confused on how we're led there. Romans 8 and 14. Romans 8 and 14. The Bible says, For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption. Whereby we cry, there's those words again, Abba, Father, Dad, Daddy. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. If so, that be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. You see that? God's Spirit led us to realize that Jesus was our only path to God. He's the only way into the family of God. It's through his Spirit. He says, as we are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. And I love that last part there in verse 17. He said, If so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. So we on the same level of Jesus, once we get into his family, we're brothers of Jesus, if you want to look at it that way. He says, We're heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. Just like my brother Josh would be a joint heir with me in my family. If anything, Lord forbid, ever happened to my family and there was an inheritance, I know they don't have anything to give, but if there was anything, somebody might want the chickens. And me and Josh would be joint heirs with each other. Because we belong to the same family. If you've been saved today, you belong to the same family of God as every other Christian on the face of this earth. And you are a joint heir, not only with God and your other fellows and brothers and sisters in Christ, but you're a joint heir with Jesus Christ, our Lord, the one that's died for us and saved us of our sins. You become the same joint heir with Him. Now, I don't know about you today, but that makes me feel quite special. That makes me feel like somebody. It makes me feel lifted up knowing that I belong to the Heavenly Father, because the Bible tells me that He owns the cattle on a thousand hills. He created the universe. He spoke the world into existence. He created man out of the dust of the ground. And I belong to Him, and I'm part of that. I inherited all those things through God. I've been adopted with full inheritance into God's family. I love that. You know, we also are a legal heir, legally. You know, everything you go to do in an adoption process is legal forms. I'm sure my parents filled out all kinds of papers before they adopted my brother. And there's legal forms, and they all have to be notarized and stamped and sealed and all these different things. Same thing with God. We are legally stamped with His seal. How do I know? Ephesians 1 and 13 says we were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. And he goes on to say in verse 14, who is the inheritance, the earnest of our inheritance. So we were sealed. We were legally bound, and it's binding. We cannot be taken away from Him. We belong to Him. He sealed us with His Holy Spirit of promise. And I love that, thinking about that this morning. You know, this thing, adoption, it is a process. Adoption is not something you just do casually. Adopting someone is not something that you just on a whim or fancy go out and say, I'm going to adopt somebody, I'm choosing him, let's go. It doesn't work that way. Adoption is a long, thought-out process. It's something you've took to your heart. It's something that you want to do. It's something that you want to share with that person or that child. You want that person in your life. Adoption takes a planning process. I remember when Paul and Jennifer Dockery were in the process of adopting that young girl that they adopted. Her name is Clarissa Jane. Clarissa Jane. They went all the way down to the Caribbean and to adopt this little girl. They fell in love with her down there and got to hold her and watch over for a little while. And then they had to come home. And they had to go through this process. It was legalization process. It was money after money they were pouring into this thing. And I remember the first time that they tried to adopt. And they spent thousands of dollars trying to adopt this baby. And it fell through. And they lost all the money they'd put into it. And they were heartbroken. But they still trusted in God. And they kept praying and praying and seeking God on this. Because they knew they wanted to adopt this little baby. And then it came through for them. It came through for them. They was able to. And this just past Christmas, they got to go down there to the Caribbean and bring home their little baby. Oh, and you ought to see all the things that they post a picture of her almost every day on Facebook. They love this baby. I mean, you know how it is to be a first-time parent. But they love her to death. And it took a lot of planning, a lot of process. There was a lot of thought, a lot of heart went into that. Do you know that God thought about us before He even created this world? Do you know He looked out? It wasn't just some little whim or fancy of God to take you into His family. It wasn't a last-ditch effort to try to adopt you. It wasn't something that He just one day said, man, I'll take them. Do you know He planned it? He planned it way, way, way back there. Look at Ephesians 1 and 3. Ephesians 1 and 3. He's been planning our inheritance and adoption for a long time. Ephesians 1 and 3. The Bible says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as He has chosen us in Him, look at that, before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before Him in love. Verse 5 says, having predestinated us into the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to Himself, according to the good pleasure of His will, to the praise of the glory of His grace, wherein He has made us accepted in the Beloved. Do you see that? Before the foundations of the world, He went back there. He predestinated us into the adoption of His children through His Son Jesus back before this place was ever created. He looked out and He saw you. He knew you. He knew your name. And He said, they're one of mine. And He planned it all. It was a long planning process on God's behalf. And I'm glad it wasn't just a little thought, just a passing thought, that He said, all right, I'll let them in. No, He said, I planned this all along. I've been planning it. All right, there's some benefits and we'll be done. There's some benefits of our inheritance of God. Some benefits. Listen to this. Do you realize when you inherit this adoption through God, when you become one of His real legitimate sons, when you've been sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise and you're an heir and a joint heir of Christ, do you know there's some things right now that we enjoy in our inheritance? Right now. God's never going to pass away, okay? God's not going to die. God's not sick, never has been, never will be. He's never going to pass away, but we will receive inheritance. But we're going to receive some of it. We receive it now. We receive part of it now. Listen to this. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 19, Galatians 5 and 19, the Bible says, "Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanliness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envies, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in the past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God." Okay, so the person not saved will not inherit the kingdom of God. You see all those things he lists, all horrible things. They're not going to inherit the kingdom of God. But listen, verse 22 says, "But the fruit of the Spirit," that's what you have when you get saved, you have the fruit of the Spirit within you, "is love, is joy, is peace, is long-suffering, is gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts." Do you see what all we inherit in the here and now? Not in the sweet by and by, like we just sung a while ago. Not in the sweet by and by, but in the sweet here and now, we inherit those things from God. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. In the here and now. Too many times I look out upon Christians today, and boy, we don't act like we inherited anything. Nothing but a hard time. Nothing but gloom and doom and all kinds of awful things. And you look at the average Christian today, they walk around so defeated and beat up and they just lost all hope. I've even heard people, you know, preachers that preach the gospel and something happens to them in life. Something they lose a job or something happens to them personally. And boy, they're just ranting and raving and acting like the world's against them and they're hopeless and helpless. Friends, God gave us all these things through the Holy Spirit that we have available to us, love and joy and peace, long-suffering, meekness, all these different fruits of the Spirit. We enjoy now of our inheritance. Not then, now we do all these things. You know, these things we inherit upon trusting Jesus Christ is our Savior. And these are things we enjoy every day in the here and now. But now I want to look at some things we're going to inherit in the sweet by and by. You know, this morning it seemed like every song we sung was talking about heaven. You know, we sung that, you know, what a day that's going to be. You know, and this is just what heaven means to me. We just kept singing about them. And then we sung in the sweet by and by, which I've heard some people say a church should never sing those old songs like that because it puts people to sleep. Puts you to sleep? Talking about the sweet by and by? What God's got laid up in store for us that's going to put you to sleep? You've got a problem if that's putting you to sleep this morning. I want you to know we are going to we get benefits when we inherit these things from God in the sweet by and by. Listen to this. According to Psalm 37:29, says, "The righteous shall inherit the land and dwell therein forever." Do you know one of the great promises God gave his covenant people of Israel was they were going to inherit the land. They talked about it all the time. We're going to inherit the land. He promised the land of Canaan where milk and honey flows, where the grapes they're carrying around, you know, look like bowling balls. I mean, all these things that they were going to have in the land of Canaan, and they were so looking forward to it, and they talked about it all the time. And God said, "I promise you this. This is yours. You're going to inherit the land." And he gave them that land. He gave them Israel, and we know the 12 tribes that's laid out, all these things. They got that inheritance. But you know, there were some of them there that was looking even further than Canaan. Some of them there was looking even further than Canaan's land is just in sight. They were looking on beyond that. I remember the Bible says that Abraham was looking for a place, a city whose foundations were not made by man's hands, whose builder and maker was God. That's what Abraham was looking for. He was looking for that heavenly city, the one that's coming down, the Jerusalem that's going to come, the sweet heaven that we're all going to see. That's what we're going to inherit. We're going to inherit the land. Hebrews 1:11-10 said, "For he looked for a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God." You know, we're not Jews today, but we are sons of Abraham through the Spirit. We're a spiritual son of Abraham We're not a physical one. We're a spiritual son of Abraham if we've been saved through Jesus Christ. God engrafted us into his plan of salvation, even though all along he'd been planning it, like I said, for the foundations of the world. And we become joint heirs of Christ. And we will inherit the land. We'll inherit heaven. Not only will we inherit the land, but this is one of the greatest things we're going to inherit, everlasting life. Matthew 19:29 says, "And everyone that has forsaken houses or brethren or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my name's sake shall receive 100-fold and shall inherit everlasting life." The Bible tells us in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world," and you're the world, I'm the world, "that he gave his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, that whosoever should believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." We have everlasting, eternal, never taken away life. How's that happen? Because he's going to usher us into his heavenly kingdom. We're going to live with him forever in heaven. Friends, we have that inheritance given to us. Oh, I'm so glad of that today. We inherit that eternal, everlasting life and all the things that heaven entails. Now I want you to look with me over in the last book of the Bible, Revelation 21. Revelation 21, second to last chapter in the Bible. Revelation 21, verse 4. I like hearing those Bibles rattle around. I like to hear God's word. Revelation 21, and verse 4. The Bible says, "And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. He that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. He said unto me, It's done. I'm Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh," and look at those words, "shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son." You see that? Full inheritance of the Father. Full adoption into God's family. We become his sons, and what do we inherit? We inherit heaven. And all the things that abound in heaven. Do you see that list of things? No death. No more standing by the caskets anymore. No more funeral processions. No more this sitting in the hospital holding somebody's hand and feeling their last breath and hearing that death rattle. No more of that ever again. There'll be no death in heaven. It's been done away with. No sorrow. So many people today are filled with sorrow. Things happen to them on this earth. I know a man very close to me whose son has made him sorrowful. I mean, his life is just torn apart because of the things his son has done. And he's got sorrow. There'll be no more of that sorrow in heaven. There'll be no crying. A lot of times I cry when I get happy, and I don't know particularly if that's what it means, but he says no crying. I believe that to mean tears of torment and tears of unhappiness and tears of things that's happened to you, because nothing bad is ever going to happen to you in heaven. There'll be no tears of sorrow in heaven. And I like that part right there. No pain. No pain. You know, I hear some of you sometimes. You know, I talk to people on the phone. Somebody just this past week had an accident and they had pain. They, you know, I worried about them, was praying about them. And pain in her backs, pain in her legs, pain in her feet. You know, people having to walk down these steps back here in the front. And how it hurts your joints as you walk down those steps and your knees pop and go on. And how you worry about that and it hurts. And you know, when you have other people in your life, your family members that have things go wrong, they have physical ailments like cancer and things in their bodies, and they have pain. And that's one of the worst things, to know that somebody you love has this pain and you can't do nothing for it. There's not a thing you can do to help them at all because they're in such pain. I can't ever forget the memories out of my mind as I sat there at the bedside of my sister as she was laying in the hospital in such pain. And she probably didn't even know my name at that time. She was in such pain and she was in agony, and it was the worst thing you've ever witnessed in your entire life. And it just hurts. But you know what? In heaven, there won't be any kind of pain like that. There won't be any kind of cancer. There won't be any losing hair over radiation and chemotherapy. There won't be any of this stuff. You won't be taking medicine for arthritis and medicine for high blood pressure and cholesterol and diabetes and all these other things that we have to deal with. There won't be any pain up there. It's going to be wonderful. Because he said what? He said, we inherit all things. All things we inherit. Why? Because we shall be his son. Women, that's you too. It's a universal term when it's talking about you're going to be his son. You inherit the same things. We all become his inheritance. Yeah, you know what? We're going to be adopted. We are adopted. If you've been saved today, you've been adopted by God. You belong to him. He's your heavenly father. He's your Abba father. He's your dad. He's the one that loves you. He has full inheritance for you to enjoy now and full inheritance for you to enjoy then. You know, right now all we can do is look forward to that day. I like to talk to old brother Frank. He's not here this morning. He's sick. But I like to talk to him, and he has that look in his eye. He's had that look in his eye ever since Eunice went. And he looks off in the distance, and he talks about Jesus. He talks about heaven, and the tears come out of his eyes. And you know, and I just love to talk to people like that. Friends, there's going to be a day. Those people that's went on before us, those loved ones we've lost, those little children that you lost as a young baby that's went on into heaven, those little babies, you'll get to reunite with them. Oh, and it's going to be such a time of joy. Because why? Because we've inherited all that stuff. Can you imagine going through this life without Jesus and no hope of inheritance of that? There's no hope of inheriting the things of heaven. No hope of inheriting a pain-free life, because we know what those that are not saved, they have an inheritance too. They have an inheritance from their father, the devil. You know what that is, don't you? The Bible says it'll be cast into a lake of fire where the worm dieth not, where the fire is never quenched, where there'll be weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Friends, that's their inheritance. Why would people go through this life not trusting Jesus, their Savior? Why? 1 Corinthians 2:9, and I'm finished. The Bible says, but as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. Friends, our Father has so many things planned for you. He has got things. The Bible says our eyes never even, we've never seen anything like it. These ears of ours, we've not ever heard anything that even can compare. Oh, and he's got all those things ready for us as we get to take our inheritance from him as being a full heir, adopted with full inheritance. Amen. Ladies, come and get the invitation song this morning. I'd like for us to stand today, and as they play the invitation song, I want you to examine your heart. Friends, I trust that everybody in this building today has that inheritance waiting on them. I hope you do. But if you don't, boy, I sure hope that you make things right before it's too late, because you won't get to any of these benefits. You won't get any of this inheritance coming to you. So if you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior, if he's been speaking to your heart, if he's been convicting your heart this morning and letting you know that you need to be in on this inheritance, you need to trust me as your Savior, not your pastor, Jesus Christ, you need to trust him as your Savior. Through him, you become a son of God. Through him, you get the inheritance. If there's one in here this morning that needs help with this, you come to this altar this morning as we pray and they play this song. And I want you to come down and pray.